Freezing cold fails to deter the biggest anti-government protests in Russia in years. Thousands demanding the release of opposition leader Alexei Navalny are arrested. Will the demonstrations gain momentum and pose a real challenge to Vladimir Putin? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the program. I'm Mohammed Jamjoom. People in Russia have defied police warnings and freezing temperatures to hold some of the biggest protests yet against President Vladimir Putin. Tens of thousands rallied in nearly 70 cities to demand the release of Alexei Navalny. The opposition leader was arrested as he returned from Germany, where he'd been treated for a poisoning he says was ordered by the president. Security forces detained more than 3,000 demonstrators, triggering condemnation from countries including the U.S. and U.K. Navalny's supporters are promising more protests. Sonia Gallego reports.
From the far eastern city of Vladivostok, Navalny's supporters faced off with police in sub-zero temperatures. The authorities had denied permission for the demonstration, but it didn't stop the crowd gathering to call for the release of the man leading Russia's most prominent opposition movement. In the capital, Moscow, tens of thousands had gathered. Police using batons on the crowds. Some were forced back by protesters as they chanted, "Freedom for Alexei Navalny." Among those detained, Navalny's wife, Yulia. Apologies for the poor quality, she wrote on her social media page. Very bad light in the police van. As much as President Vladimir Putin has attempted to play down Alexei Navalny's influence, the arrest of one of Russia's most prominent opposition leaders has only inflamed his supporters.
The law is being trampled on in an absolutely incredible manner. This arrest is one of the most serious violations of human and civil rights in the Russian Federation. It will set a precedent that could lead to the destruction of all our civil liberties.
Earlier in the week, Navalny had released a video alleging President Putin was the owner of a billion-dollar property on the Black Sea. This was denied by Putin's spokesperson. For Navalny's supporters, corruption is a major source of their discontent. And the constant crackdown on their movement is, they say, an attempt to silence them.
I'm fed up with keeping quiet. We've been silent for too long, and it's probably time to speak. That's my position. Time to say that we have the right, that we have the freedoms, and that we have the desire to live in a completely different country.
Navalny may not pose an immediate danger to President Putin's power, but economic problems in the country are ongoing, as is the discontent. And some analysts believe the Kremlin fears the potential of a Belarus-style mass dissent and the prospect of more protests. Sonia Gallego, Al Jazeera.
All right, let's bring in our guests. In Moscow, Sergey Markov, director of the Institute for Political Studies and former member of the Russian Parliament. In London, Domitilla, Sagromoso, lecturer in security and development at the Department of War Studies, King's College, London. Also in Moscow, Maria Lipman, senior associate at the Institute for European, Russian and Eurasian Studies at George Washington University. Welcome to the program. Maria, let me start with you today. The fact that there were so many people coming out in so many cities across Russia, despite the cold, despite the pandemic, despite the risk of arrest, does that suggest to you that these protests will gain momentum?
It is very hard to say at this point. We had protests before. We had them over the years. Protests are usually of emotional character, not of political ones, and they have a tend to rise and ebb. It is true, however, that this time round, the geography of the protest has been much broader than ever before. And what is also important is that the slogans that people chanted were the same in basically the same everywhere. So what we have now is clearly a minority, but a sizable one, that feels strong discontent with regard to the Russian authorities and with regard to the Russian regime. This seems like some change compared from before. However, it is not clear at this point whether this might be yet another wave that will ebb with time.
Sergey, from your vantage point, do you believe that Alexei Navalny poses a threat to Vladimir Putin's grip on power?
No. Vladimir Putin has no threat in terms of politics and the popularity among population. Among Russian people, because support of Alexei Navalny very narrow. It's limited only by those people who believe that in the conflict between Russia and the West, Russia is guilty forever, and Russia should diminish its sovereignty and to be subordinated to the United States and European Union. As you understand, with Russian great history of sovereignty, the number of such people very small. That's why we have support of Alexei Navalny, very active, even aggressive, but very small from political point of view, from electorate. On the elections, Alexei Navalny will have no chance at all. But Alexei Navalny only has threat because he just weaponry of the real enemies of Vladimir Putin, which is, first of all, intelligence service community of the United States and Great Britain and another country of US-led coalition. This is a real threat. These people made the coup in Ukraine. They tried to overthrow also president of Belarus. And now they will try to organize political violence in the period of the upcoming parliament elections, which will happen on September of this year. This is preparation for the calling this election not free and fair.
Domitilla, you heard Sergey there talk about the upcoming elections. Of course, in September, Russia is going to have these parliamentary elections for the State Duma. Do you believe that what's happening now could have an impact on the election?
Well, I think that, that's the objective of the demonstrators and of the sort of the Navalny and his followers and his team. I mean, the effort is really to try and see if a sort of an anti-United Russia coalition can be established, which could have an impact. And I think that's what really the Kremlin is quite worried. And I think I disagree with Sergey. I think there is concern in the Kremlin. Otherwise, they wouldn't have taken all these precautions. There wouldn't have been efforts to persuade people not to go, curbing, for example, access to certain social media platforms. So I think the Kremlin is worried, that there could be a sort of a potential backlash in the elections, although not at a massive scale, but the beginning of a significant turn, and that there is pressure for political pluralism because of a lot of the realities of the situation in the ground. I think that Russians, those who sort of coalesced around Navalny, not necessarily his only his followers, but people who are probably dissatisfied with the overall situation in Russia, with the economic situation, with the COVID, the impact of COVID, concern about the poisoning of Navalny. So I think that there is a possibility that there is some impact, but of course a lot will depend on how the Kremlin manages this opposition, what will happen with Navalny, and whether the momentum, as Masha pointed out, can be sustained. And I think that there are many months ahead, and it's not very clear. What is clear is that the government is really eager to avoid sort of the Belarusian scenario of a sort of a constant line of series of demonstrations on a regular basis. which increase in time.
Maria, I'm curious to know your thoughts about something. President Putin has largely stayed out of public view the last several months. He's been working from his residence a lot of the time. And there's this perception among many that he's just essentially trying to stay out of view. When you compare that to the fact that Alexei Navalny, you know, returned to the country where he was poisoned, that he knew that he most likely risked being arrested when he returned. Are those optics damaging for President Putin? Does this mean that Navalny has gotten the upper hand?
Well, I would still not overestimate the upper hand for Alexei Navalny. There is a conservative constituency in Russia. At least one-third Russians will vote for powers that be, whatever the situation, whatever is happening. There's another third that will support Alexei Navalny, and certainly not because he in any way represents the West and is a hand of the West. He's a totally homebred politician, and his supporters admire his courage and share his discontent and his outrage over the corruption in the country. About one-third are those people who are, by the way, totally unrepresented in the Russian legislature today. And this is actually the core of the problem. People are protesting because there is no way for them to engage politically. And there's also one more third that is actually refrains from politics and evades politics and would like to stay away from politics, but maybe can't be mobilized by Navalny's supporters if they sustain the momentum, as Domitilla say. If this wave does not ebb but continues to rise, we may see a division that will not be into three-thirds, but maybe something different. And Navalny will have more supporters. It should never be underestimated that the state has gigantic advantage over the public in Russia in so many different ways, including and maybe first and foremost law enforcement bodies and the government's readiness to use them against the public.
Sergey, President Putin does not refer to Mr. Navalny by name. State-run media outlets largely depict him as an unimportant figure. Based on what happened, you know, with these protests, do you think that that's going to start to change?
I don't think that will change too much because Alexei Navalny is not regarded by Russian elite, by Russian ruling class as an independent Russian politician. Absolutely not a home-based. He's regarded just as a clear, plain political agent of the Russian enemies, first of all, of United States. And that's why Vladimir Putin didn't mention the name of the guy whom he regard not independent by agent. Putin's eyes, Alexei Navalny is some kind of Mr. Smith from the movie Matrix. And Putin's enemy, it's Matrix, but not Mr. Smith. Matrix can produce a great amount of such Mr. Smith and who will attack the Neo. Vladimir Putin, in fact, it's a new Neo of the global world. It's something this picture show very well. Why Alexei Navalny a little bit out of direct mentioning. And his popularity in Russia is very small because exactly this. It's very small number of Russian citizens want a clear, plain agent of the United States to be leader of Russia.
Domitilla, Alexei Navalny's team released in the past few days a video on YouTube, which they said was an investigation into a property on the Black Sea that was allegedly owned by President Putin. This is a claim, of course, that the Kremlin has denied, but this video has been viewed tens of millions of times since its release. And it's just the latest in a series of videos that Navalny's team say shows corruption at the highest levels in the Russian government. How damaging has this video been to President Putin?
I think it has been quite damaging. I think it's, on the one hand, it's a bit early to assess exactly what the impact has been. But from what I saw yesterday, I mean, people were great. I mean, there were some who were really upset about the fact that there is this sort of luxury with, you know, people with whom I spoke. There is a great concern about the Russian elites, you know, spending all this money, you know, when the Russians, you know, Russians are still, many are in sort of a situation of poverty and not doing very well, when the last years, the situation of the economy has not significantly improved and, you know, wages have been stagnating. So I'm sure it has had an impact, especially maybe among the younger generations. And it also has had an impact abroad, I think now. I think that many abroad are starting to question, because there is a constituency abroad that is very supportive of Putin. And I think these events are starting to have sort of a questioning. So for me, it's easier to judge at this moment how people are perceiving Putin abroad. I think that internally, what is really important is the younger generations, those that are have been growing up with Putin all these years and haven't seen an alternative leadership. And I think that now these younger generations are much more antagonistic towards the Putin leadership than previous generations. And I think that the real problem to determine the popularity of Navalny is that in Russia there are no proper free and fair elections. So it's very, very hard to know exactly how popular he would be in an open and fair context. So it's, I mean, we can claim that he's popular, he's not popular, but all of this, you know, is very hard to assess if we do not have an open and effective system of competition.
Maria, are there indications that there are differences of opinion within various factions of the Russian government over how exactly to handle Mr. Navalny and his case going forward?
Well, if there are differences, they are hidden from the public eye. There have been no defections, that's for sure. And this is one of those advantages that I mentioned when I was talking about the government, the Kremlin, Putin's elites vis-a-vis those who are critically minded in Russia. There have been no defections, no signs of defections. A very recent Duma session had all factions of the Duma parties unanimously, very angrily, very passionately, and I would say very energetically denouncing Navalny. It was a demonstration of loyalty to the regime. I cannot interpret it otherwise. It looked like the lawmakers were competing in eloquence in how else they can vilify Navalny. There may be differences. There probably are differences. There may be differences between different agencies. Law enforcement may be different from the Kremlin administration. But even if such differences exist, we do not have hard evidence for that.
Sergey, let me ask you. The U.S., of course, has condemned what happened at the protest. They've also condemned the arrest of Alexei Navalny. You've had the EU also condemn the disproportionate use of force against protesters. How is all this going to affect Russia's relationship, especially when it comes to the new Joe Biden administration in the U.S.?
First of all, I think it will be this United States' strong support of Alexei Navalny will be broadly broadcasted in Russian media. And as a result, the reputation of Alexei Navalny will be damaged again. His popularity will be again limited because of this. As to U.S.-Russian relationship, it will damage not too much, because U.S.-Russian relations now so awful that such support of the on political ally from Washington, it's something what absolutely had been predicted by everybody, and it was expected. Mostly important is, first of all, the relationship between new institutions. Either new administration of President Biden will be ready to reestablish some kind of consultation about security issues and others which have been blocked during previous years. And also, which is mostly important, is how far Washington administration will go to the intervention to Russian domestic politics. We expected that United States will interfere Russian domestic politics very intensively during this year, especially in this connected with parliamentary elections.
Domitilla, while public awareness of Alexei Navalny may be growing in Russia right now, do Russians actually know what Navalny stands for, what his platform is?
Yes, I think they do. But what is interesting, I think there are two elements. First of all, I think there is a lot of concern, as was noted in your initial introduction, about the treatment of a Russian citizen and the attempt to poison him and the decision to actually then send him to prison when he comes back to Russia. And I think that is something that now Russians in this group of those who are opposed to the system, this one third which Masha mentioned, I think there is a lot of anger, probably, or worries that this is sort of the new nature of the regime, and they really don't want that. I think he's known for his videos. The videos that he produced in the past have always attracted a lot of attention. A few years ago, there was a video produced about Medvedev's and his own corruption. And I think that is something that tends to mobilize people. But I think the coalition is a bit broader. It includes people who are dissatisfied with the system. And no matter whether they would support Navalny, I heard many saying, they do not like the fact that he's been treated in such a way. And if I may just come back to the point that was raised by Sergey, I think that these events do have an impact. I think that the new Biden administration is going to look very carefully and denounce much more vehemently the behavior of the Russian leadership, and in Europe in particular. And Europe is very important, especially if we think about, for example, Nord Stream 2, which is a project that is very dear to the Russian leadership. And I think that a few days ago, there was a big resolution that, for example, Nord Stream should not move forward if Navalny is not released or if there is not a better treatment of him. And so I think that there will be pressures also at European level to do something about Navalny. Now, it may be it may be interpreted as interference in internal affairs, but certainly it touches a chord. It touches a chord among Europeans very much.
Maria, we only have about a minute and a half left. Let me just ask you, could Alexei Navalny have remained an effective opposition figure or opposition leader if he had stayed outside of Russia?
Certainly not. And I think this was the main reason why he decided to come back. Being a popular political figure, not a leader of an organized opposition, certainly not, but the most popular opponent of the regime, if he had stayed abroad, that would put an end to his career as a public politician.
Well, let me ask you one other thing. When it comes to that third of the Russian population, do you think that those who support, that you were talking about, that those who support President Putin, is it possible that they might now, he might lose support among those?
Well, it's hard to tell. I'm talking about one third that is generally the more conservative Russians, older Russians, people who rely on state television and its propaganda as their source of quote unquote news. This is the main difference. Age-wise, people are different. This is where the line of division goes. And the source of information, the vast space of the internet with its social networks, with its YouTube, with its Instagram, et cetera, Twitter, versus television that mm-hmm. has become a mouthpiece of propaganda.
All right, we've run out of time, so we're going to have to leave the discussion there. Thank you so much to all our guests, Sergey Markov, Domitilla Sagromoso, and Maria Lipman. And thank you, too, for watching. You can see the program again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com. And for further discussion, go to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJInsideStory. You can also join the conversation on Twitter. Our handle is @AJInsideStory. For me, Mohammed Jamjoom, and the whole team here, bye for now.